but you can't seem to get enough. Let my love open the door. Let my love open the door. Let my love open the door to your heart. When everything feels all over, when everybody seems unkind, I'll bring you a four-leaf clover. Take all the worry out of your mind. Let my love open the door. Let my love open the door. Let my love open the door to your heart. Heart, I can stop you from falling apart. Try today, you'll find this way. Come on and give me a chance to say, let my love open the door. It's all I'm living for. Release yourself from misery. There's only one thing's gonna set you free. That's my love. So lucky I'm around. Let my love open the door. Let my love open the door. Let my love open the door to your
morning. Welcome to worship. It's so good to be back with you all. As I think you probably have heard by now, we were with a group of 20 in New Orleans, Mississippi, and Alabama, and I'm very happy to report that not a single one of our group got eaten or bit by alligators, so I count that a successful trip. I was in a boat that was came close to that when we did our swamp tour in Mississippi, got stuck on a stump, and had to wait for someone to come pull us out. And thankfully, our tour guide had plenty of marshmallows to keep the alligators away from us as we were waiting to get rescued. But overall, we had an amazing trip. I want to take a moment to acknowledge and say thank you to our volunteer leaders who are with us. So Nick Ferrante, cool under pressure, amazing driver, just first aid extraordinaire, gave a lot of time and energy. And then they're not here today. They're probably napping. Tammy and Damon Schaefer as well, if you get a chance to see them. We're so grateful for our volunteers that helped make this trip possible. So we're going to share some memories today, and then in a few weeks, our youth will be sharing more for our youth dinner as well. But some announcements as we're getting started. We want to acknowledge and say a huge thank you to everyone who's contributed so far to our mid-year stewardship special appeal for the renovation of our showers. This is our dedication weekend, our final dedication weekend for gifts going to that project. We are really close to our goal. We've received just over $17,000 towards our $20,000 goal, so that's something to celebrate. So I want to give thanks to God for that. And also give thanks for the additional gifts that hopefully will get us up to that goal this weekend. A little later in the service, we'll be saying a special prayer of dedication for that mid-year special appeal. And then announcements for our weekend. Pastor Manuel's here. He's just hiding over there. Mm-hmm. You going to come up here?
I was waiting for my cue.
So some announcements for our week ahead. We do have our summer craft and quilting group that will be meeting this Wednesday at 10 o'clock here in the community center.
And our Seekers book discussion group will be meeting on Wednesday at 6 o'clock in here in the community center. If you have any questions or want information about being part of that book group, you can contact Carol Houston.
And our Prayers and Squares Quilt Ministry will be meeting next Saturday, August 3rd as well, at 10 a.m. here in the community center. And there's not a lot of explanation. It just says salad bar lunch. So if you have any questions about our prayers and squares or the salad bar lunch, you can contact Stephanie Alexander.
And we have Vacation Bible School coming up for those entering preschool up to sixth grade to be part of that. And so we do have a board. I guess it's outside in the courtyard. The board's out there. You can pick up a coupon after that for that from that board and bring that item in to donate to Vacation Bible School. We also have, we also still have registrations available, so we're looking for those registrations.
And if you are have signed up to volunteer to help with that, we will have a volunteer training for adults, and our youth will be helping the day before, the weekend before, and so we'll be in touch with more information about that as well. And then we know while we were away, Pastor Karen Marone was here filling in for us. We heard she gave a beautiful message, and we're grateful that she'll be back with us coming up on August 10th. It's a Saturday from 10 to 12. She's going to help lead us in our Christ Bearers training. This is our ministry where we train people to bring communion and prayers to people in their homes. And so if you're interested in being a part of our Christ Bearers ministry, you can come to that training with Pastor Karen. You don't have to make a commitment at that time. You can just come learn about the ministry and be a part of the training. And you can let us know by checking
the
box.
Blue slip. That was stuffed in your bulletin. You can check the box off on that blue slip. Also on that blue slip is our teenagers' lunch. They have a change of venue for this coming month. They'll be meeting at the Olive Garden because Vacation Bible School will be here that Thursday. And so you can let them know that you plan to attend that Olive Garden lunch on those blue slips.
And then make sure to just read through our announcement pages for other updates and information coming your way. If you're online with us, you can click the link in the chat for that as well. I think those are all of our announcements. We do have two flower arrangements this weekend. One given by Rachel Line in memory of her mom, Pastor Lori Line. The other given by Ray and Phyllis Blanchard in celebration of Silas's fifth birthday. So those are our flower arrangements for this weekend. And those are all of our announcements, so we'll continue now with our call to worship from the Peacemakers.
Oh, people, look around you. The signs are everywhere. You've left it for somebody other than you to be the one to care. Inside your houses, there's no time to find you now. Oh, your walls are burning and your towers are turning. I'm gonna leave you here and try to get down to the sea somehow. Help you if they can. Now everyone must have some thought that's gonna pull them through somehow. Well, the fires are raging hotter and hotter, but the sisters of the sun are gonna rock me on the water now. Rock me on the water. Sister, will you soothe my fevered brow? Rock me on the water. I'll get down to the sea. I'll get down to the sea somehow. Seabird above you, gliding in one place, like Jesus in the sky. We all must do the best we can, and then hang on to that gospel plow. When my life is over, I'm gonna stand before the Father. The sisters of the Son are gonna rock me on the water now. get down to the sea somehow. Rock me on the water. Rock me now. Rock me on the water.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Gracious God, you have placed within the hearts of all your children a longing for your word and a hunger for your truth. Grant that we may know your Son to be the true bread of heaven and share this bread with all the world through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. And we sing our opening song, Will You Come and Follow Me, the summons. We're going to sing verses 1 and 5.
First reading is from the second book of Kings, the fourth chapter. A man came from Baal Shalisha, bringing food from the first fruits to Elisha, the man of God. 20 loaves of barley and fresh ears of grain in his sack. Elisha said, "Give it to the people and let them eat." But his servant said, "How can I set this before 100 people?" So he repeated, "Give it to the people and let them eat, for thus says the Lord, they shall eat and have some left." He set it before them, they ate and had some left, according to the word of the Lord. Word of God, word of life.
And our holy gospel is according to St. John, the sixth chapter. Jesus went to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, also called the Sea of Tiberias. A large crowd kept following him because they saw the signs that he was doing for the sick. Jesus went up the mountain and sat down there with his disciples. Now the Passover, the festival of the Jews, was near. When he looked up and saw a large crowd coming toward him, Jesus said to Philip, "Where are we going to buy bread for these people to eat?" He said this to test him, for he himself knew what he was going to do. Philip answered him, 6 months' wages would not buy enough bread for each of them to get a little. One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "There is a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. But what are they among so many people?" Jesus said, "Make the people sit down." Now there was a great deal of grass in the place, so they sat down, about 5,000 in all. Then Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to those who were seated. So also the fish, as much as they wanted. When they were satisfied, he told the disciples, "Gather up the fragments left over so that nothing may be lost." So they gathered them up, and from the fragments of the 5 barley loaves left by those who had eaten, they filled 12 baskets. When the people saw the sign that he had done, they began to say, "This is indeed the prophet who has come into the world." When Jesus realized that they were about to come and take him by force to make him king, he withdrew again to the mountain by himself. When evening came, his disciples went down to the sea, got into a boat, and started across the sea to Capernaum. It was now dark, and Jesus had not yet come to them. The sea became rough because a strong wind was blowing. When they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the sea and coming near the boat, and they were terrified. But he said to them, "It is I. Do not be afraid." Then they wanted to take him into the boat, and immediately the boat reached the land toward which they were going. This is the gospel of the Lord. Let us pray. May the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, our rock and redeemer. Amen.
Well, as you heard in our welcome, and as you probably well know, we were in New Orleans last week with about 17,000 of our Lutheran youth from the ELCA for our youth gathering. It is hard to describe the energy and excitement that was there in that group as people descended from all over the United States, Puerto Rico, and the Virgin Islands for a week of learning, worship, serving, and of course, because we are in New Orleans, some eating as well. Our own group of 20 arrived in 2 waves. The first 5, including myself, participated in the multicultural youth leadership event.
Then the remaining 15 of us flew into Birmingham to pick up rental vans to drive into New Orleans. And I have to say, it's a good thing that we did, because did you all hear about a little snafu with the computer systems for the airlines? There were groups that were trying to get out on Saturday of New Orleans, but because of all the issues with the airlines, didn't get home until Wednesday or Thursday. We did not have that issue, which I'm very grateful for, because 2 reasons. Because we were flying in and out of Birmingham, so that helped. And we also happened to be flying Southwest, which I guess was the one airline that had an ancient enough computer system that it didn't, wasn't affected. So we had like minimal issues with our travel, and I was so grateful for that. When we arrived in Birmingham, we were warmly welcomed by our new friends at Shepherd of the Hills Lutheran Church, which, by the way, if you go to Birmingham, we recommend going to visit our friends there. That was a really wonderful congregation. They hosted us on the first night and then again on the last few nights of our trip. There were so many meaningful things that happened. I wish I could just like mind meld everything with you and share it all with you. From the inspired speakers at the mass gatherings, to the worship songs that we sang together, to the service and accompaniment work we did with a local congregation there in New Orleans, to the hospitality that was extended to us by the locals everywhere that we went, to the challenge that we experienced as we learned about civil rights history in the American South. Throughout it all, I witnessed our youth carry with them open minds and hearts, trusting that they had the prayers and support of their families and their churches back home.
Our theme for the week at the gathering was Created to Be, which is the same theme we use for our stewardship emphasis here at St. Andrew's. And we did do that on purpose, by the way. At the gathering, though, we learned about how created to be, created us to be brave. God created us to be authentic. God created us to be free. And God created us to be disruptive disciples of Jesus. We saw the way that our own group had to step out of their comfort zones, which can be very difficult. for our youth and their parents, it was hard for me to explain what a youth gathering is. What it is to gather for prayers, songs, and messages with 17,000 other people. What it is to fill a convention center full of youth-related games and activities, to eat meals together every day for a week with the same group of people that you're also sharing a living and sleeping space with. In the midst of the disruption from the normal schedule, we feel God's presence with us, comforting us and speaking to us. We see the miracles that God performs within communities and also within our own hearts, the abundant healing and forgiveness that faith in Jesus gives us in all the circumstances of our lives.
We did want to share a few snippets from some of the speakers that were so impactful. On the first night, we heard from Dr. Michael Chan, and we learned this phrase that he repeated. He said, "You were precious long before you could prove it. You were precious long before you could prove it. And you are precious just as you are created to be."
And from Dr. Jacqueline Bussey, we heard that in the midst of very deep grief and loss, God spoke to her through graffiti on a dumpster, which said, "You will be happy again."
From Pastor Lori Fuller, who is a pastor who leads a deaf ministry in a deaf congregation, she gave her entire talk in ASL, and she had a very expressive face as well as she was speaking. And she taught us a sign. And I don't know if any of the group that was there remember the sign that we learned. It's not the easiest sign, but she wanted to teach us this sign. If you go like this, "You are not a mistake. And I am not a mistake." We're going to work on learning that a little bit more during our children's time today. One of the other things that Pastor Lori talked about as a person who is deaf is how hard it is to lip read when the people around you are eating. And I believe in that part of her talk, she did the sign for the word gross, but I don't remember that sign. But I do remember how impactful it was to have her teach us to look each other in the eye and teach us this phrase that you are not a mistake.
And from Pastor Emily Herkins, we learned when we truly see one another, then and only then will we truly see Jesus. See me, see you, see them, see us, see Jesus.
So this gospel text from John provides a beautiful framework for us as we recognize the abundant gifts we have in this congregation and how those gifts overflow out into the world as well. And then how in the midst of storms, Jesus walks towards us, offering us peace. Both of these stories in the gospel are moments when Jesus sees and brings out the good in the people he comes to teach and serve. In the text, when they see the crowd coming, Jesus asks, "Now, where are we going to buy bread for all these people to eat?" And then it goes on to say that he said this to test Philip because he himself knew what he was going to do. I like the idea that Jesus maybe even had a little playful smile on his face when he said this to Philip. I also like the idea that Jesus enjoys the anticipation of knowing that he is about to help make a miracle happen, one that will be talked about by those 5,000 plus people and the generations that come after them.
And last Saturday, we experienced communion with three times this many people in the keep calling it the softy serve dome, but it's actually called the Smoothie King Center, the arena. And volunteers were sent out into the stands with bread and grape juice. And when the time was right, they just seemed to magically appear in the aisles. I hope that this unique way of sharing communion is something that our group will remember and talk about as well. And as I was thinking in this version of the feeding of the 5,000 story, It is the offering of this young boy, a child, that inspires the miracle that leads to everyone eating and having their fill. All Jesus does is give thanks, and somehow 5,000 eat to their fill. Gather up the leftovers, Jesus says, so that even those who show up late can have a plate.
Yeah, thinking about this boy and his innocence and trust in Jesus to do something with his offering of 5 loaves and 2 fish, it reminds me of some of the small miracles that we get to witness Jesus doing in our midst through our life together here all the time. We see the miracle of sandwiches and fruit and cookies appearing at memorial service receptions for those grieving the loss of a loved one.
We see the donations of fabric and supplies arrive so that prayer quilts and Lutheran relief quilts can be sewn together for people to experience a little comfort.
This last week on our trip, we saw at our own Synod and Region Worship Day, which was the day when everybody from California and kind of the southwestern region of the U.S. Spent a morning together, that the entire worship service was completely led by high school students, even though there were 5 bishops in the room, as well as dozens of pastors and adult leaders. The only times that our bishops spoke was to co-preside at communion. And even then, it was the whole crowd who said together, "Do this in remembrance of me." You know how hard it is to have 5 bishops in a room and not have them speak? That kind of felt like a miracle, you know?
Well, it's these kinds of miracles that leave leftovers behind, spilling over. Just like in the gospel reading, enough so the blessings can be passed on to those who maybe didn't witness the events directly, but can still benefit from hearing the story and seeing the results in their own community or family.
We know that it brings us hope and joy to see children and youth sharing God's love. It serves as a powerful reminder of why we are here and how we all make a difference together in the world. Sometimes it is very easy to get jaded and cynical, to focus on all of the negativity and to allow our energy and enthusiasm to get zapped. But when we do that, we may be missing the good things that God is doing right in front of us, the things that are life and purpose giving.
And in our text today, the miracle of the feeding isn't the end either. After seeing the results of Jesus' blessing in the story, the crowd is amazed to the point of being overwhelmed. They want more of what this rabbi has to offer. So inspired, they want to rally, to crown him their king, like a joyous mob after their team wins a championship. However, Jesus knows that, like this meal that they just had, this isn't going to satisfy them for long. Nor will their exuberance for crowning him king. In fact, a similar crowd will soon become the crowd calling for his crucifixion. Jesus knows that there is a lot more to faith in God than just a full stomach. And so Jesus slips away from the crowd, only to reunite with his disciples in the midst of a storm at sea, calling out to them, "It is I. Do not be afraid."
There's something grounding for me in the idea that there is no circumstance that we face where Jesus can't find us, even as storms rage around us or within us. This is something we can cling to and find hope in as people of faith. Nothing that we face can or will separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. How often do we in the church feel like that boy with 5 loaves and 2 fish? We don't feel like we have much to share, and the world's needs are so overwhelming. As individuals, we might feel paralyzed with our sense of scarcity. But as we see ourselves as a part of something bigger, our perspective can begin to readjust. Or how often do we feel lost in storms that feel so strong and powerful? But as we experienced firsthand, almost every day on our trip last week, right at about 3 p.m. every afternoon, the storms do come. And the winds rage. But they do not last forever. The sun will always rise again.
We don't always know where this gift of faith will lead us. Faith is not certain, firm, or unwavering knowledge. Faith is being in conversation with God, being drawn to a God we don't fully understand. Faith is growing into all that we are created to be, knowing that there is always more to learn and more to experience with God's abundance. So in fact, we are called just like the little boy in our story and his little Lunchable. That little boy didn't know how or what Jesus would do with what he had, but he had courage of faith to give what he came with and believe that something good would come of it. What you may feel is so very little makes a tremendous difference in the kingdom of God, where it is gathered together with others often. That is the miracle of the story for us and for them. And one final quote from the youth gathering from Pastor Sally Azar, the first woman Palestinian pastor ordained in the Holy Land. She shared, "Do not be afraid of God's calling. You are created to be a disruption, to disrupt what is wrong, to work for what is right, for life, for hope, for justice, for peace."
If our experience of our youth trip this last week is any indication, we are blessed when we share our space, our time, and our resources with others. God multiplies our generosity, and we are blessed to discover the great abundance of God's blessings, not just for us, but for all. After all of this, everything is a free gift given to us in Jesus Christ. Jesus gave of himself to the point of his own death on the cross, only to rise again to give us more, to give us the gift of new life, his life, now and always. There are many things in our world that divide us, but the love of God is always calling and beckoning us back to the table to be fed, and then to share that bread of life with others and be reminded of who we are created to be. And it will always be enough. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Amen.
Walking in the sky, sinking sand took my hand.
Together with the whole people of God, we confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As we continue with our prayers, and we're praying prayers of peace and comfort for the family and friends of Stacy. This is Pastor Manuel's niece who passed away Thursday after a battle with cancer. So prayers especially for her four young children and all who loved her. We also pray for peace and comfort for the family and friends of Joy Davis. This is Mert Nisley's daughter-in-law who also passed away yesterday following a battle with cancer. So we give thanks to God also for the lives of Stacy and Joy in our prayers this weekend. At the end of each petition, you'll hear "In Your Mercy," and you're welcome to respond by saying, "Hear our prayer." One in the communion of saints and in the power of the Holy Spirit, we join our voices in prayer. God of generations, you work in us far more than we can ask or imagine. Bless the church you have called into being across time and space and fill it with the power of the Spirit for loving service. Lord, in your mercy.
God of field and forest, streams and seas, you are the fullness of all things. As grains of wheat grow upon the earth and fish swim in the waters, sustain your creation. Protect harvests and give every person food in due season. Lord, in your mercy.
God, beyond borders, you rule all in all. Bless the work of humanitarians and peacekeepers. Shield those who live, work, or serve in harm's way, and bring an end to war and conflict. Lord, in your mercy.
God of grace, you root us and ground us in love. As you inspired our ancestors in this place and their ministry, sustain us also in our new endeavors, that your glory may be known and your loving kindness shared anew. Lord, in your mercy.
God of healing, you open wide your hand and satisfy the desire of every living thing. We remember any who are sick or suffering, families in our community who endure hunger, those in need of housing, and our beloved for whom death is near. We offer now the silent prayers of our hearts. Lord, in your mercy. Holy God, holy and merciful, into your outstretched arms we commend ourselves and all for whom we pray, trusting in the one who is the way, the truth, and the life, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
We share a sign of peace with everyone around us. May God's peace be with you. For those online, God's peace be with you wherever you are. At this time, as we continue with the offering, I want to take a moment to say a prayer of gratitude and dedication for, again, our mid-year special appeal. I'm giving thanks to God for all the gifts that have already been committed, and then this weekend as well, as we pray a dedication for those gifts for this project, we'll say our prayer. God, we thank you for this opportunity to serve you through all that you have given us here at St. Andrews, and especially through our facilities and for the hospitality you empower us to provide for people in need. We pray special prayers of dedication for those commitments made for this mid-year special appeal, and pray for you to bless and sustain our efforts as we seek to serve you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, and we continue now with our receiving of the offering.
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what perfect in all of your ways.
Let us pray. Risen One, you call us to believe and bear fruit. May the gifts that we offer here be signs of your abiding love. Form us to be your witnesses in the world through Jesus Christ, our true vine. Amen. All right, you want to invite the kids up for children's time? You all going to come up? Good morning. Hi. Ooh, you brought a book today. That's, you always bring books. I love that. I love reading. Does anyone else love reading?
Me.
Yeah? What about learning? Do any of you love learning? Some of you excited for school to start soon?
I'm going to middle school.
You're going to middle school, Kyrie? Mm-hmm. Are you a little nervous?
A bit.
A little bit, yeah. How many of you have ever had to go to a new school, right? It can be a little bit of a nerve-wracking thing, but you know what, Kyrie, you're going to do just fine. I just know it. I wanted to talk to you about how cool it is to learn new things, and I want to share with you something new that I learned, which I talked about in the sermon, but if you didn't see it, I learned a new phrase in sign language, in American Sign Language. Have any of you ever learned sign language? You know a couple things? Yeah, we have a few people here who know some ASL. Who are some people who know a little bit or a lot of ASL over there? So I learned this really cool phrase. There was a lady who was talking about how important it is to remind each other that God created you to be who you are. Hi. God created you to be who you are. And she talked about how she's been deaf, and so she's always used her hands and her face to communicate things. And one of the phrases that she taught us is this. She taught us to say, you are not a mistake. And this is the way she taught us. She made her hand like this. Everyone want to try that? And then she tapped her chin like this, kind of with her knuckles. And then she shook her head at the same time. And this is harder than it looks. You have to shake your head and tap your chin. But it's important that you look at the person when you're trying to give them this message and say, you are not a mistake. Ooh, I almost got it that time, I think. Do you want to practice it? You want to look at someone near you and say to them, you are not a mistake. Did you get it? Congregation, do you want to look at someone and try that? You are not a mistake. Isn't that, I hope I'm getting it right. If any of our ASL experts have a different way, this is what Pastor Lori taught us. It's like patting your head and rubbing your stomach at the same time. It's a lot harder than it looks. Yeah, just like that. And I guess, you know, this is kind of a hand signal some of us see, right? But it's to go like that. Eventually you kind of get used to it. And then the other thing that she taught us was how to say that to ourselves. We say, and this is good. You can look in the mirror and say this to yourself. I am not a mistake. Can you try that? I'm not a mistake. You know what? And sometimes, especially when we hear negative voices from other people, it's important to find that, remind that in yourself, that God created you to be who you are, and that's a special gift. And so it's good to be who you are and who God created you to be, and to remember that you are not a mistake. And you know what? Sometimes what I think is so cool about ASL, American Sign Language, and other things is, like, sometimes words, it's hard to find words. But maybe we can use our hands to share a message like that sometimes, right? So we're going to say a prayer, and then we're going to have communion. And you're welcome to stay up here for communion. God, we thank you for all the different ways that you give us to communicate your love and care for others. And we thank you that that message is also just for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right, we're going to turn around and look up here at the table. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. And so we remember in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat. This is my body given for you. And then remember what he said? He said, do this for the remembrance of me. Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. And then he said, do this for the remembrance of me. Now we're going to fold our hands and bow our heads and pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as you forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. All right, you all can head back to your seats. Thank you for coming up. Do you want to welcome you all to communion this morning? You do not need to be a member of this church or Lutheran. All are welcome to come forward, eat, drink, and receive. In just a moment, we're going to invite you up. We're going to make a circle here around the altar. We'll come around and serve you a piece of bread. We also have gluten-free crackers available. If you need that, let us know. And then individual cups of wine or grape juice. The wine is the lighter color liquid. The grape juice is the darker color liquid. After you've received those elements, we'll collect your empty cups. And then after that, you'll be invited to take hands with your neighbors so we can offer you a blessing. And then following that blessing, you can return to your seat down the side aisles. If you are not communing at this time, we still invite you to come forward. We just ask you to fold your hands so we know to offer you a blessing. And then finally, it is our practice to serve communion by first name. So if you don't have a name tag on, we may be asking you for your name. That's everything you need to know. The table's been prepared and all are welcome.
You'll be okay.
Stephen, the body of Christ.
You'll be okay. The sun will rise to better days, and change will come. It's on its way. Just close your eyes and let it rain, 'cause you're never alone, and I will always be there. You just carry on, you will understand. You'll be okay. Close your eyes and understand, you'll be okay. You'll be okay. You'll be okay.
Let us pray. Shepherd and God, you have prepared a table before us and nourished us with your love. Send us forth with this banquet to proclaim your goodness and share the abundant mercy of Jesus, our Redeemer and friend.
Amen. So I think you all know this, that in addition to being a wonderful piano player and vocalist, Coley is a baker extraordinaire, and she made us really good cinnamon mini muffins this morning. So please join us in the courtyard for a little time of fellowship. Thank you, Coley. You're doing a lot this morning. We appreciate you. And now receive this benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Amen.
Our closing hymn is Praise the One Who Breaks the Darkness. It's words and music are in the bulletins, or the words will be on our screens.
Praise the one who takes the call.
priests, you are the body of Christ.
Thanks be to God. Singing glory,